here is that at some point in time, the thought was, and I think Kirstie wanted to come in and give us an update on the library. And from a timing standpoint, it worked out well. Obviously, the bids were opened, and we've looked at what, well, reviewed what they were, what the costs were going to be, and of course assessed how much the library had to put toward the project. And I think that's that was the spirit of the meeting in that respect. And I think there's some comments that were made in the media and the like that might have distorted that sort of thought, or at least the idea of coming and then giving us the update, which we all of us here want to have. So with that being said, is that the township doesn't have an issue with the library, and it is very supportive, and we can highlight that this evening if necessary. But I think if everyone has been to the meetings and have seen the breakdown and the idea of what we've tried to do with the library and will continue to do, we haven't wavered from that support. So if you like, Kirstie, if you want to come up, and we can address more of that from your side if you like, but of course, we want to hear what you've got.
Okay, certainly. I'll do that. Good. Okay,
that's the better one.
Good. I'm glad to hear it. And I may ask for assistance. Mike and Mark, but we'll start. This is just kind of a broad overview. And I was going to give a little bit of background for some who aren't familiar with what a library board is. This will take 2 minutes. The library board is an official municipal board that runs the library. Most trustees are appointed by the mayor to serve 5 years. The library board has the responsibility to manage the budget for the library, hire the director, and plan for the future. Now, another thing that causes a lot of confusion sometimes is funding for municipal libraries in New Jersey. It's done through a guaranteed third-of-the-mill appropriation through your property taxes. So that's been law for over 100 years, and that's how. So it gives steady funding. And we've been able to fund our library through lean times as well, on just the minimum funding. On your everybody's residential tax bill, you see it as a set line, and it's about 1 to 2% of your tax bill. And we have been able to operate on it, and we will, in the new facility, be able to operate on that funding. So our idea is that there's no increased taxes because of this. The library board works very closely with the township committee. Either the mayor or his designee serves on the board. Together we plan for the future. We've done that through the master plan. The standalone library has been on there for over a decade, I know, at least probably 2 decades. And then more recently with the municipal parking lot, which is going to benefit the downtown area. We have public meetings first Thursday of every month in the library. We welcome everybody to come here. So in short, we work closely with the public, the township, and our landlord, the school. And we've been doing this for quite a few years. Okay, planning for the new library has been a years-long collaborative process. To ensure that this wasn't going to be a tax burden, although we kind of saw that the future was not going to be to ask the town on the whole thing, we realized that we needed to form a foundation. We did that in 2009, and we began fundraising in 2011. So right now we have about $2.5 million in the bank, and about $100,000 in committed pledges through July. And the township has agreed to fund the parking lot and do the site work, and allocated money for that in this budget. And the township has stipulated that we have the funds in the bank before construction starts, plus 5% contingency. We've gone through the planning board process without the professionals' input. In addition, the site design went through a major revision based on neighborhood input, and that actually resulted in a much better design. We're very happy for that. When all the processes were done and completed, we assessed that we had sufficient funds in the bank to be within the range of a competitive bidding process, so we went out to bid. So that's why I'm here tonight to report to you officially on the public record what the bidding process is. The bids were opened in the library on Wednesday, July 26th, following the rules of municipal bidding. It's public, it's open to people. We had 17 bidders, the total base cost ranging from $3.09 million to $3.96 million. three lowest bidders were given to architect and lawyer to qualify. They'll review the applications to see if they have filled out everything, whether they have their full, whether they're fully bonded. We're gonna be checking, not us, our, the architect and lawyer will be checking references, making sure that they're fully in compliance. Three lowest bidders did come in all clustered around 3.1 million. This was in the higher range of what we were expecting. So there is a little bit of a shortfall, basically. But in, the library board has until September 27th to respond to these bids, and we plan to take this full amount of time in order to allow the architect and the lawyer to vet these lowest bids. And this time always also allows the foundation to do more fundraising. So that's it in a nutshell. I know you might have a lot of questions.
Now, just one question I have. Is there a thought, I mean, maybe it's impossible, but phasing it, could you start at a smaller footprint and then phase in additional community room, or that's not an option, really, 3.1 is where you have to be.
I'll say what I have to think, but then I'll definitely ask other people to chime in. So many, we have really pared it down to the minimum of a good functioning library, and a lot of our supporters love the community side of it. A lot of our supporters love the children's side of it. It would be really hard to lop off something and go forward. But I don't know. I would agree.
Right, so phasing, I don't necessarily just cut it off and never build, but phasing would also create too much of an issue, it sounds like, with your
donors. I wouldn't say no, but if, you know, some of the stipulation is that, you know, township of Sedum makes all the money in the bank.
One other thing is to do that, we would incur a lot more architect and planning costs, and we really don't want to sink more money into trying to pare it down. And the other part is the community center also has our bathrooms.
So also, I think, is, and we've talked about this too, that there's a talk from a state point of view that there'll be a referendum in November that may open up funding that could go toward the libraries. That's still, as far as you understand, is that still?
That's sure. That is going forward.
Okay.
Yeah, it's definitely going to be on the ballot in November. So that, you know, is definite, and it was signed by Governor Christie in July. But this still needs to be voted on, so it's not a guarantee, and also we may or may not be a good candidate for that. You know, there's some ifs, and then also that pushes things off, costs will increase. So although I think this is an excellent thing, the library community definitely needs this, it's long been neglected statewide. We just can't hang our hat on, in my opinion, it's not a guarantee.
And so the bids are valid for 60 days, correct?
September 27th.
Okay. Other questions or?
I was gonna say the Library Construction Bond Act is, they even have the wording that's gonna be in the ballot. I received that like at 5 o'clock today, and a lot of information about it. So, I mean, it's definitely going forward. The library community knows about it. They're going to push it and, you know, let people know about it.
Yeah, I think assembly persons we talked to about it seem to be fairly supportive, is my understanding.
Oh, I talked to the assembly people, not only this April, but the previous April and previous April. We've been asking them for this bond construction on that for a long time. And this April, I knew all of our local representatives to the state were either sponsors or co-sponsors of this act. So we thanked them at that time, and we keep them in touch.
What's
the value of the referendum, the
dollar value?
$125 million. Up to half the cost of a project that's shovel ready, I think, if I'm oversimplifying.
It's 50% and it should be shovel ready when you get the grant. And it does say either township funds, township bonding, or donated funds can be used for that.
Okay. Are there questions at this point? Or? Thoughts? Anything else on that? Or, okay. One thing I again want to say is I think you've done a fantastic job. I've been in fundraising programs where I haven't had half the success you've had, and I understand that the shortfall. referendum coming up and the like, because it'll help us then, of course, release the funds that we have earmarked for the project too. So, I know it sounds like we're directing the same old thing, but it is hurtfully good job that you've done, and others, Mike, et cetera, and everyone in the room. I know a lot of familiar faces that are part of this project in particular, but again, you have our support on that. And I'm going to do beginning at both of us. So, thank you again. Okay, at this point, reports from township staff, professionals.
On behalf of being a resident of Cranberry and the status of the library. I think many of you know I volunteer on a lot of committees and boards, and I volunteered to help the library get this project moving. Initially, I was not a big supporter of the project, but after getting attacked for donating, I said, well, if I'm going to donate, I better make sure I'm getting my money for it. And I think we've done that. And I see the library as something more than a library. This is a community building in town that we desperately need. A couple of my boards and that I sit on, we don't have a good place to meet. We meet the History Center, we cram in there. CHA's annual meeting, if you've been there, was crammed, people in. It's really a disaster. We need a good meeting hall. And that's why I've been so supportive of the library and community center. What I want to speak to are the dollars. Committee has said we support it. Verbal support of a project like this is not enough. Committee has authorized up to $475,000 for the parking lot, design and construction. Today, that's not enough. Based upon the cost for the design, the redesign through no fault of the library, and the low bidder, the total site work cost is $565,000. So question number one for committee, are you willing to fund the full cost of the parking lot design and construction at $565,000, which is above the $475,000 initially authorized?
If you're asking for an answer right now, well, the answer is no, only because, and I can explain why that would be, but you know, we based a lot on what we were able to provide based on cost and projections provided by yourself. So
it was provided by the township engineer, provided those costs on the original design.
But which would have to, was approved through the process, as you know, in order to formally present them out to bid.
So that's, again, it's somewhat of a question, but a rhetorical question. And I think I, as a resident looking for your support on this project to get it done and give it to the community so we can use it, we would look to that additional funding to really fund that part of the project. As originally talked about. The other aspect on the overall fundraising is the contingency. And I think that is kind of a soft number, and I would suggest that if we can get this project going now, that we can authorize the contract with the additional funding of the parking lot and with zero contingency to sign a contract. That will allow the project to go ahead. And that would bring us down to a total need of two, round numbers, 2.6 million, with 2.4 raised, we have a shortfall of 200,000. And I think for those of us in the community that are still willing to donate more to this project, to know that our target is 200,000 is a lot easier to look at than 400,000. So again, I'm asking everyone on the committee to think hard about providing the additional funding for the parking lot and reduce the contingency request at this time, so that by September 27th, we can raise another 200,000, which I think is doable, and knowing where we are on the balance of the project. This also then allows, hopefully, the bond issue going ahead in November and all the other aspects that we can have the additional money coming from that bond issue to take care of any shortfall that could develop, as well as fund the rest of the project that has been stripped out so that we can have a fully furnished library. So these are numbers that I think committee really needs to talk about, and not just the verbiage, we support it. Support is nice, but just like we're all elected, support is nice, but you need a vote. So what we need is some dollars to donate to this happen. So I request you think about it hard and hopefully get back to the community, to the library, as well as community at large, that you're willing to put some more money into this project than you had.
Now, the contingent, my understanding, when we put that number together, I remember the back and forth, and what is, I guess, up to 20%, which, if I'm thinking of the same number, which it's not 20%, if I'm not mistaken, it's 5. So we did want to work on that as best we could within professional reason. Now, none of us here, including myself, or I'll speak for myself, are not an engineer, and so in that respect, how that process functions, I'm not as clear, but the 5% was much lower than the original 20, and I understand your point here, so just for benefit of everyone's information, that's how we came up with that 5%.
Yes, the real issue is dollars. If we wait a year, we're losing that money. It's going to be a 5 to 6% escalation on construction costs now. It's gone. So all we're going to do is just keep throwing money away. We're going to be filling a bucket of water, and there's a big hole in that bucket. So we as taxpayers are really going to be losing.
Yeah, the dilemma, though, is, I mean, you build a lot of projects. You tell me, don't you consistently go into your contingency fund to finish those projects? Have there been projects that you come in below?
Well, we definitely want to see a contingency, but with the thought of getting a contract signed, a lot of people are still holding money back. They don't believe this project's going to happen.
Okay.
And I think getting a contract signed allows us to get going. And there's a lot of time within the construction time period of 12 months to find the additional funds necessary.
Yeah, and I think, again, looking at contingency, we can assess that, and I just don't know, and I'm just speaking off the cuff, and that's probably the worst thing to do. But looking at that, the number's low already. If there's some sort of ability to revisit that, where it's, from our standpoint, it's good stewardship with our aspect of the project, and of course we'll look at it. I don't want to make it sound again as we're just throwing a verbiage at it. I do want to say that we are throwing monies toward the project. That's where the $575 comes from. Also, the property itself came from Township, which is collectively all taxpayer dollars, too. So there's factions of the Township that we internally on the Township Committee have to work with that are not as supportive. And so it's been a fine line, as well as somewhat of an art and a science, trying to get where we are. But I understand your point, and we'll revisit. I think contingent would be the easier of the two, but we'll look at that and see what we can do.
Okay, thank you very much.
This is fundraising. We're hoping that the number came in where it needed to be. The discussion we had with neighbors, just to echo Mark and Otter's point, is there's a lot of discussion of "I'll believe it when I see it." So one of our bigger donors was the First Constitution Bank, and the president of the First Constitution Bank sits on a hospital board, and he's like, "Just start building it, and people will come forward and do that." And there's definitely some portion of truth to that. We believe that to be true. I recognize that as a foundation, we committed from the very beginning that we would build all the funds. And so we've now taken it from a seven-digit number, an eight-digit number, down to a six-digit number. So I think if there's a way to piece together the timing of the bid, the bond that's coming, the site work, and our commitment as a foundation to continue fundraising, I think we're now down to those moving parts seem like we should be able to make something work on this. That's more my observation. Looking at this, I think we are caught in a situation where this is going to continue to escalate. So we'll see what happens with the bond, but I think if there's a way with the moving parts by September 27th to not have to go out for bid and deal with the escalation of the moving target, that'd be great. And you have my commitment as the president of the foundation. I'm happy to continue going. And I do know, we do know several people that have said, well, when you know the final amount or when you're ready to go, I'm there with another check. So that's not anecdotal, that's our real experience. So thank you very much.
Mike, before you go, so what I'm hearing so far there, if I get this right, there are three asks that I'm hearing tonight. One is to increase the amount of money we commit, another $125,000.
So the ask, there's no ask from the library.
No,
or the
from the support of the library, I'll put it that way.
Yeah, exactly.
we're being asked to increase our contribution to parking lot site work by another $125,000. Is that the right number?
About $91,000.
91?
Yeah, so it's from 475 to 565, so it's about $91,000. The contingency on the building is 5% is $133,000. So
what you're asking is that we lift that, that we don't require a contingency.
That's a proposal that was raised again, given what the numbers are, $133,000. That would put the gap down to $200,000.
Okay.
If we do that, and then assuming the pledges that are coming in, so the range of a liability would be between 200 and 300,000. 200,000 would be a gap, another 100,000 in pledges that have not been paid but are outstanding. So that would, gap would be between 200,000 and 300,000. So that would be that. If those are the three moving parts, if there was a way to work that out, we would continue as a foundation to fundraise. We could be able to lock in these prices at this rate. We also know from a foundation standpoint, once we, physical space, people that do capital campaigns all the time, it's all about the physical space. Once we can have a kickoff with the groundbreaking and we can have fundraising, there's going to be time during that. People want to see that it's actually happening and the wallets.
Yeah, there's momentum.
There's momentum around that. We've had a very, it's been very amazing to see families write checks and think about bricks and think about naming opportunities. And people are now at the point where they're starting to, we're encouraging them to imagine the space. Imagine what you could do in the space. Maryland's team is all thinking about the first 100 days in the library. I think of it as not the library moving across the street. I think of it as a new space. And I look forward to the day when we can say, let's start to collectively as a town imagine the new space, what that looks like. What are the middle school kids going to be able to do in it? What are the families going to be able to do? What does it do to the main street to have that at the end of Park Street, Park Place, as a connected, walkable downtown? I want to get to the part where we start to enjoy thinking and imagining about all the things we can do in the space. I want to get past the moving target of it keep moving further ahead. So you have my commitment as the president of the foundation and on behalf of my foundation members that if there's a way to put the moving parts together and not deal with the cost escalation issue, we will continue to fundraise and we will continue to close that gap. So that's my personal commitment.
So the reason I ask this, so what we also are yeah. being asked or questioned is, if we do these things, let's say we do these things, and that funding doesn't come in.
The state funding or the our
state funding? Right. Or just that, they're you tapped it out, let's say, and there isn't, they don't come in over their wallets, then we would need them to fund the rest of it in order to have the building be viable.
That
so we need to answer those concerns when people ask us, what happens if?
Yeah.
What do I say?
Well,
just believe.
That building, when it gets the ground broken, believe. It will happen. We are in about the minute. It happens.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Right, that's understood. If I can just comment too, I understand the points that were made collectively by everyone here, and I realize the more softer issues of 5% contingency. We'll look at that. There's an ability from, again, it's a safe stewardship position from our standpoint, we'll look at it. I don't know what to say about having all the money in the bank, but that's, again, something that we can look at that's more of a soft target. I can't say anything about putting in more money up front toward it. I'm going to say that's probably not going to happen.
Site work?
I don't know. I'm just saying the 475 at this point. Now, the site work, I think it gets to Susan's point, is that we have to be able to assess, and I don't want to do this now. We're going to have to kind of circle back because, again, there's entities that aren't as supported as maybe we are and we'd like to be, and myself too. So some of this we'll have to look at and then see if there's some flexibility in there. What I would do, like to also find out are the mechanics on the referendum. So if in fact it were to go through, maybe there's a retroactive component where the monies can be put toward higher cost because you have, let's say, more than 25 or 50 or 75% of the money, there's going to be, I guess, criteria that they'll have, and we need to find that out. I think it was just mentioned that some of Maryland had that criteria on draft form, I'm assuming, might have came through this afternoon.
I don't think it's draft form. I believe that they already had the wording for the bond, and were you talking about potential sources?
Criteria, of course.
Well, criteria for it. We don't have to itemize it all, but right. Send that along to us, if you will. But so that's what I can say we can look at now, and I understand the position and the level of frustration, too. I've been on the fundraising
side. I guess the way to think about it, to Susan's point, if you want to think about these three cost buckets, and honestly, I hadn't really, if we bring these down, I haven't been thinking in the way that Susan had. The one is purely for the site work, which is sort of the estimate of the commitment. The one is a risk, is a sort of a risk, covering the risk of the contingency, which could or not. The other could be a fund that's covered and the foundation continues to work towards that. So really the out of pocket could be purely the site work of the 90,000 and covering the risk and the contingency, and the foundation could be, could work towards, you know, paying back. So from the good news is, from 5 years ago, we were conceiving a $3 million library, 3.2 whatever million dollar library. We're now down to the point where the real ask would be the incremental and site work, and, you know, working on some kind of timing issue, you know, maybe $200,000. So that's actually good that we're now down to about the same order of magnitude as a police car that we pay as a town. We're really down to that kind of order of magnitude. So I think as a foundation, even though the original intent was we're going to keep marching forward and we're going to raise all the funds, we're now so close that we're chasing it. And I think if there's a way we can all, and this is so preliminary, if there's a way we can figure out how to do this, take advantage of this lower bid, maybe do some value engineering on the lower bid, and really try to, you know, really get it so the actual risk exposure is in the six digits, I think that would be great.
Is there any more value engineering to be done on that, or have you done that? Or?
We've gone through all that from really day one, the basic design, we went through that, and the suggestion to have Greg Farrington look at it was excellent because he picked up a lot of little things that could have cost us money later. So my office has looked at, so we've had a lot of eyes trying to eliminate the potential for problems later on.
Okay.
Yeah, so I just turned, thanks everybody for your support to this project. It's been